Good day, all. Ira Epstein of Linn Associates with your agriculture update for this particular July 3rd, 2019, and we're just getting on to 3 p.m. Central Daylight Time. Happy Independence Day to all. Now remember, we get abbreviated trading times through the holiday. We'll be open on Friday, normal times, all the markets open again. So today it's one of these funny days. So many people left early. I'm probably one of the few people left in the office. The news of the day that propped up soybeans and corn was that now they claim China might do more grain purchases. And it's funny because Larry Kudlow came out late today and saying that we could see China and the U.S. meet as early as next week, and that he's expecting more in the way of purchases from the U.S. if they can get these talks done. He's not mentioning the intellectual property. And without that, I don't know that you go anywhere. If President Trump were to make a deal without that, I don't think that his election, the people behind him would go for that in any manner. So I'm not certain where they're at on it, but the market likes what it's hearing. Talk of the U.S. and China, again speaking, good news. Gold market up. One of the reasons I found out that the gold exploded yesterday was because one of the nominees that President Trump's going to present is Ms. Stone, I believe her name is, and she is a gold advocate, back to the gold standard. So when people heard that, the gold market took. I couldn't for the life of me figure out what was going on there. So in the soybean market, at least this point in the week, we're down 14 and a half cents. I'll say it again, this market might make a run towards that 18-week average of closes. Don't know. When we take a look at the daily chart, there's a gap still left here. This does not have to be filled. You've already filled one gap, another gap. So gaps have been filled. There is one left, and charts often do fill them. The question is when. You fill the closer ones at this point. The trend is still down. If you put on the swing line, and this is a chart without it, what the swing line does is it looks at the previous day to where you're at now. And I created five separate rules when I created this tool so that I could easily look at a market and define if it's in an uptrend or downtrend by the concept of a downtrend is one that has lower highs and lower lows, an uptrend has higher lows, higher highs, and no trend's gotten some manner a higher high and a lower low with it. And it also defines risk. If one were going short down here, to break this pattern, you'd have to get over 934 and a quarter. Is it 934? Let's see, what is that high? 934 and a quarter. That's quite a bit of risk from here. It's 26 cents or so. So that's quite a bit of money. Resistance in the market can be seen at the 100-day and the 18-day average of closes. Support was not hit. That would be the lower Bollinger Band. But what the market's now doing is it's starting to bring in these two bands to itself as the market is sort of running out of downside steam. Remember what we talked about before. You're oversold in a market that's not making it yet to the lower Bollinger Band resistance above the market. When you come to the meal market, yesterday the market had gotten down and closed under the lower Bollinger Band and the day before. The odds of staying under a Bollinger Band are 5% of the time. And one of my rules of thumb is that when you get successive closes under or over it, each successive number, so if you have two of those, you have a 3% chance today coming in that the market will stay under that band. So you bounced away. That's not a trend change. It's just that you're back within the bands. Resistance in this case, I think, is going to become the 100-day average of closes because numbers that were prior in moving averages support become resistance if they're sliced through. And you can see this market did slip down to the 100-day, fought a battle there, and now if it's coming back up, I wouldn't be surprised to see that that's some resistance. Backing that up is the 18-day average of closes at 317.10, and if you took out 318.40, you'd break the downtrend that's in place. In soybean oil, the market scooted back up and over the 18-day average of closes. And for those of you that get my morning subscriber video, one of the things that I've been talking about in that was this market's getting dragged. It's not the leader. The leaders are the soybeans and the meal. So it's just being whipped back and forth along with the other two. in the corn market, I expected that we were going to see short covering down here, and I know I said it the past 2 days to you in these videos, and you're getting that. I'm not saying it's a trend change, because there is no trend. You have a higher high, you have a lower low. I'll see resistance back at 449.5, but this level of this decline probably ran its course. Same thing in the wheat market. You came down, and if we take a look at this, this was on Monday's action. Yesterday you hit the lower Bollinger Band in an oversold territory, and today you run back up 11 cents on that. In the sugar market, sugar and cocoa are very strange right here. They've got patterns of higher highs, lower lows, no follow through. You come down, you hit the Bollinger Band, you're rallying back towards that 18-day average, son of a gun to trade. The coffee market is staying bullish. This market is trying to get its embedded reading going, which means it converts from overbought to staying bullish. The market's gotten over this 18-day average. It did it in May, and it's really been staying very nicely over it. And the pattern is one still of bullishness. In the cocoa, like I said, it reminds me of sugar. You've got the lower low, the higher high, you make a run to the downside, will you be able to hit the Bollinger Band and then spin back up? This is what gives people white hair like I have. Difficult market. In the cotton market, this market's been trying to tell us a story. It's got a lower low and a higher high. It's not trending. It gets to the upper Bollinger Band. It failed last time. I have no reason to believe it's not going to fail here and try to pull back. We'll see if that is in fact the case. Then we get to the cattle market, which again, this market's fighting a battle at the 18-day average of closes, and it is trendless. You have a pattern of a higher high, lower and low. I'll argue that resistance is 107, supports 104.65. In the feeder cattle market, again, yesterday the market, nice day up 135 higher. Today you lose 180 points. The market is still in an uptrend, and this is the support zone. There's quite a bit of risk, though, here from there to the lower 134.40 area, and momentum is trying to come down. I'll give the nod still to the bulls until the 134.40 is taken out. Another failure in the hog market against this 18-day average of closes, and this has been a son of a gun for this market for months on end. Yes, you have a pattern of a higher low, higher high, but as I said yesterday, will you get any follow through? And yesterday you finished 78.97, just underneath the 18-day average, not able to follow through very much, and today you get thrown back. It tried to get over and stay over it, but now you have an outside day down. Take out today's high on Friday or Monday, and then I think it gets more interesting. Then you might have captured a group of people under you short, and the market's ready to pop. Is there a short sale here to begin with? Not as long as you've got the higher low, higher high. So that puts the market into a problem area. Does it sound confusing at times? Do you end up questioning your own decisions, what you're doing? That's what happens at holidays. But one of the things that I try to do is work with my subscribers. And in the morning, I try to get through this noise as best as we can, and I try to give you ideas as to what I'm seeing in the market. So I'm assuming you're going to have a cup of Java, which we see is in an uptrend, and I'm going to offer specific trade ideas to you. Now, the charts will look like you see right behind me. They're going to be jet black. They're not going to be this way. I'll have a few more studies on them. We're going to cover 40 charts on the futures markets and typically about 5 ETFs for you ETF traders. They'll be the ETFs obviously related to the futures market. So I'm going to give you technical analysis, going to tell you what I see. I'm going to already know what happened in Asia and Europe. So before I start speaking, I'll have an idea what's going there. And then from that, we look at the chart picture, and I'm going to give you specific entry, exit, trade ideas. What's the goal here? Well, if you have your own thought process anyways, and you're looking at these different markets, maybe that extra push is just what you need. You go, yeah, that's what I was thinking anyways. Now I see that it makes sense on a chart. How do you get access to it? It's simple. You go to our website. On our website, once you get into the education or the research area, you're going to see Ira's morning subscriber video. It will explain how this all works. It's 26.5 cents a day to try it. And then if you don't like it, what did you waste? $7.95. If you do like it, you can either go month to month, just let the credit card go, or you can switch and go to a one-year subscription for $156. It's all explained on the website, www.iraepstein.com. Enjoy yourself there, have a great holiday, and I will see you all come Friday. We'll be back Friday. Take care.